All right, welcome to the Environment and Sustainability Thrive Action Group meeting. My name is Tracy Flor Figueroa, and I am the AmeriCorps Vista Fellow at Thrive Alliance. I'm glad you could all meet with us today. I'd like to start by welcoming our new members. We're excited to have you today. And for those who are new, Thrive Alliance is a network of over 200 nonprofits in San Mateo County. We work together to strengthen the nonprofit sector and improve the quality of life in our community. The Environment and Sustainability Thrive Action Group is a forum for the nonprofits to share ideas, collaborate on projects, and advocate for policies to protect our environment. We meet about once a month to discuss a variety of topics related to environment and sustainability. Today, we'll be talking about canopy coverage inequities and how they affect communities that want to protect and manage their urban forests. Before we get started, we'd like to take a moment to remind everyone about some of the upcoming events at Thrive. Anna Mescolta, the Director of Community Resilience at Thrive, will share some upcoming events this month.
Hi, everyone. I will be quick, but we do have two events that are quite relevant to this conversation as we head into warmer summer months and we face the prospect of extreme heat. So the first event is just our monthly meeting for Thrive Rise. Again, just for those who haven't heard of it, this is the Coalition of Community Organizations Active in Disaster for San Mateo County. We meet once a month. This month, May 31st, 10 a.m., and I can put the link in the chat after I'm done, we'll be talking about high heat preparedness, and we will be hearing from health emergency preparedness from the County of San Mateo, as well as the Department of Emergency Management. They'll be going over some of the heat impacts on health, as well as some of their plans for coordinating cooling centers this summer. So again, very relevant to this conversation. And then next slide, please. Right after that, on June 8th, we have, this is part of a training series, but this one will take the form of a panel discussion. We'll be talking about how nonprofits and community groups can better communicate and collaborate with government during disasters. We had a lot of lessons learned during the storms, and this is really the beginning of a long discussion and hopefully an iterative process for how do we make this better? How do we talk to each other a little bit better when communities are going through crisis? So this is going to be a very fun panel discussion. We'll have really good snacks. It is in person at Redwood City County Center on June 8th. I will also put the link in the chat for that. And with that, we'll get back to the canopy cover. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, Anna. We look forward to seeing some of you at those events. And also for June, our next environment sustainability tag will be on active transport. So stay tuned for more information on that. And it'll be June 29th. I'd like to also express my sincere gratitude to the PCE team for their generous support with these events. And now let's turn our attention to the next topic, the main topic, canopy coverage inequities. Urban forests play a critical role in mitigating the impacts of climate change and improving our air and water quality while reducing heat, noise, and flooding. For this event, we partnered with Canopy, and Canopy is a local nonprofit organization at the forefront of urban forestry that is dedicated to addressing the disparity in tree canopy coverage and advocating for environmental and social equity, making it central in their mission. We'll also have CAL FIRE, short for California's Department of Forestry and Fire Protection. It is an agency dedicated to protecting and serving the state of California by safeguarding its forests, wildlands, and urban areas from the threats of fire and other natural disasters. Now, we're so lucky today to have two special guests join us on this talk about this important issue. We have Maya Briones, the Advocacy Associate at Canopy. And later we'll have Walter Passmore join us from the state, or from CAL FIRE, who is a state urban forester. Maya and Walter, I really appreciate for you joining us today. Now I'd like to shift over to our next speaker, Maya Briones, who will enlighten us on the more local Canopy coverage perspective.
Hi everyone, can you hear me okay? Thanks for so much for having me. My name is Maya Briones and I'm the Advocacy Associate with Canopy. I'm here to talk through some advocacy suggestions to help support growth and maintenance of the urban forest and how to prioritize communities with the highest need. The San Mateo County communities that Canopy serves include North Fair Oaks, the unincorporated community, a neighborhood called Bellhaven in Menlo Park, and the city of East Palo Alto. And I don't know, am I clicking through the slides or somebody else? Okay. You can go ahead to the next slide. So I want to start by acknowledging the storms that happened in the beginning of the year, because this is what spurred this very important and necessary conversation. Climate change impacts are being felt more and more each year. And after years of extreme heat, drought, and fires, stressors which all weaken trees and make them more vulnerable to additional stressors, this year we faced sudden rains and wind that damaged trees and homes across the Bay Area. Many people experienced fear, frustration, and loss during these storms. And while trees were previously viewed as protectors against extreme heat, many people suddenly felt unsafe and saw the potential danger trees pose when not cared for properly. And it's true, trees can become a threat when not properly maintained and managed. And that's what we've seen. Throughout this presentation, I want to highlight the important collaboration between local governments, nonprofits, and residents to build a strong and resilient urban forest which can protect from climate change related events. It's important to recognize that not all jurisdictions are the same. Urban areas are complex matrices of a lot of different things going on, essential above and below ground utilities and infrastructure, human made and natural systems like trees and parks. And all of these together can work together to create a healthy, livable community. However, different jurisdictions have different ways of managing this careful balance. And a lot of that has to do with the jurisdiction's history. Older, smaller cities such as Palo Alto integrated tree management into their government decades ago, and so have a strong and dedicated city department for managing trees. But not all cities or unincorporated areas managed by counties have the funding to dedicate a department or even single staff arborists to provide the internal expertise and guidance needed to manage trees, nor the policies and procedures which ensure staffing these positions continue into the future. County managed communities, such as North Fair Oaks, have a government which manages a much larger area. It's more spread out, not connected to each other. Often it's the case that there's not staff capacity or financial means to care for the trees in unincorporated areas. Additionally, while some areas have urban forestry nonprofits to add support, many parts of the state do not have nonprofit support. There are some examples of conflict in urban areas that I'd like to address. Trees are natural living beings that have a natural inclination to grow, but living in urban areas means being boxed up in a rigid and more intense environment. Urban areas have more smog, pollution, concrete, weight pressing on roots, conflicts with above and below ground utilities, all that hinder a tree's natural inclination to grow. This can lead to tree roots infamously breaking concrete. I think all of us have seen that. And there are many jurisdictions in the Bay Area that require residents to pay for the damages caused by a tree in the public space outside their home. Economic and social factors also contribute to conflicts. For example, I think we all know that the Bay Area is becoming extremely more expensive to live in. And so in renter areas, high renter areas, yards are being paved over with concrete to create more parking to accommodate more people in households. And that's what we see in that picture on the right. There's often a limit to where trees can be planted. And then this picture on the left, the top left, I want to point out has a planting strip or a plantable area, but there are policies that impact the urban forest, and trees can only be planted in these areas, these spaces like this, if the process to plant the tree is straightforward, and there are policies in place that encourage and incentivize residents to plant trees. If the policies seem threatening to a resident looking to plant a tree in this kind of space, it is unlikely that a tree will be planted. Next slide, please. Thank you. And when trees don't get planted, there are some very obvious impacts. One being increased heat, extreme heat days, which also is correlating with climate change, and negative health outcomes. It might seem overwhelming to think about a future of climate change and extreme weather. However, there is a sense of urgency about planting and maintaining trees in urban areas. Trees take an average of 15 to 20 years to grow to a size that start giving us the benefits that we're hoping for, such as shade, CO2 sequestration, stress reduction, habitat. And this map is a great example of how historical development patterns created barriers to planting trees in North Fair Oaks. As you can see, the spots where there's more green, which are the green dots or trees, there are lower heat scores. It's not as heat as hot. And in the places where there aren't as many trees, there's more concrete and there's more heat. And when it's hot outside, no one wants to go outside, which means less physical activity, which means increased health issues, and lead to a greater cost of health care. And this can very quickly impact the community. North Fair Oaks has a significantly lower canopy cover than the surrounding neighborhoods. And even within North Fair Oaks, there are block by block disparities. Many of the historically underserved parts of North Fair Oaks have significantly lower canopy cover rates than the wealthier parts of North Fair Oaks. And I think we can see where those spaces are based on the existing tree canopy cover. And these disparities matter. Increasing canopy can help ameliorate current risks of extreme heat and other impacts of poor air quality, increased healthcare costs, and flooding. So some suggestions that I believe can make a difference. One of the first ones I could think of is the creation and adoption of an urban forestry master plan. And these are decades long plans that outline specific goals and tasks to achieve them. At a county level, this could look something like this, where an urban forestry master plan includes a comprehensive canopy cover data analysis to accurately represent disparities, a maintenance plan for new trees, increased canopy cover goals over time, a robust approved species list, and an equity plan that prioritizes communities with the highest need, such as North Fair Oaks. East Palo Alto recently in 2022 adopted its first urban forestry master plan, and this is a really big deal, because this urban forestry master plan generated essential data that allowed us all to understand what the specific needs of this community. There was funding that supported the development of this plan that I think is really key to mention. The funding for this plan was provided by Cal Fire as part of the California Climate Investments Program. And funding is becoming more and more available. There's an unprecedented amount of funding coming from the federal government for projects like this. So this funding and development of this plan allowed for contracted experts in data analysis, such as SFEI and Bartlett, to generate maps of data and databases that support the claim that there are fewer trees in East Palo Alto than in neighboring communities, and this how this impacts community health. Two examples of goals in East Palo Alto's plan include growing a healthy urban forest by 20% canopy cover by 2062 and 30% by 2122. And another goal is to connect with an engaged and informed community to provide stewardship of the urban forest. The next slide has some more maps generated by the data collected that I just think are really important. Data is very important to making change because it takes a lot to build a resilient urban forest, and it can't happen overnight or even in a year. Trees take a lot of work, knowing where to plant, what the specific situation of utilities and everything is in that spot, what is the right tree species for that spot, who is going to water that tree, the pruning schedule and plan, a monitoring plan, and future replacement plan should that tree fail. All of this can be supported by extensive data analysis generated by an urban forestry master plan. There are also projects that can be prioritized to make a larger impact sooner. Trees planted along freeway sound walls is a great example. The bottom right picture is a picture of the 101 sound wall in East Palo Alto, where Canopy planted trees many years ago, and this is how they are now. And they're providing a barrier between the community and pollutants and noise pollution. When trees are removed along with federal projects, such as with Caltrans, and not replaced, this puts an entire community at risk for increased pollution and noise, which can impact sleep and impact health. A great example of this is the 101 Willow Road exit, where many trees were removed and have not been replaced yet. A requirement of replacing these trees during these kinds of projects can be put in place before the projects are undertaken between the local and state governments. Local governments need to advocate for their people when federal projects come in. There's also prioritization of streets with high pedestrian accidents and high traffic and areas with high heat. We need expertise in urban planning for these things. And I highly believe that urban planners should be involved in these projects and also be educated on these issues we've discussed. Departments that are siloed will never get as much accomplished as those who work together to bring about a shared goal. Policy levels changes can be incorporated, policy level changes can be incorporated into multiple policies, urban forestry master plans, but also climate action plans, health plans, and transportation plans. And I want to highlight that there is funding out there because a lot of this can't happen without funding, and that's very understandable. There's more funding now than there was in the past because of the impacts climate change we're already seeing. And there are examples of other jurisdictions who have found funding. On the next slide, I want to highlight one of a great example of this, which is the Santa Clara Valley Urban Forestry Alliance. And the Alliance works together to leverage existing urban forestry resources throughout the county and develop and share new resources based on collected and analyzed data, community engagements, all which come together to help realize this shared goal. And what I thought is very important about the Alliance is that the allowance allows application for grant funding as a singular entity, which increases the likelihood of success and allowing all members to benefit, ending the all or nothing grant competition that's currently in place. And so long-term funding goals can be achieved when everyone is able to participate together. And I also wanted some recommendations for residents because you might feel powerless at times when you're a resident, you feel like you can't make the change that you want to see in your community. But communicating your concerns with your local government. Kind and concerned letter or email goes a really long way. Attending the local and county meetings and participating in those. The next Board of Supervisors for San Mateo County meeting is June 13th. I have a link here that will be made accessible so that everyone can find their district and supervisor if they don't know who that is. And then ensuring you understand how to care for the trees that you might already have in your yard. Arbor Day Foundation has a quick guide to post-storm tree care that we can make available. But I also want to highlight one of the main things they talk about, which is topping trees. So you might have seen this before, where trees are topped or cut at the very top. And while this might feel like preventing future failure, it actually increases the likelihood of future failure because it generates more shoots to come out of the one cut area. And these dense bundles of poorly connected branches, they don't have a strong connection, they're weaker, and they're more likely to fall. Also, when trees are topped really short, that prevents the benefits from supporting the community, the things we've talked about. And so that doesn't lead to any good benefits either. All in all, I would like to make this call for partnership because there are many barriers to planting trees for any one government, nonprofit, or community to take on alone. And collaborating together to leverage the expertise, capacity, and resources necessary to achieve these goals is what we can do to build an urban forest that is resilient. Thank you so much for joining us today. Our free trees program for North Fair Oaks, Bellhaven, and East Palo Alto. If people have questions, can call Arlene. There's her contact information. Anyone interested in advocacy or have concerns can call me. We have an advocacy committee and are looking for members of any of these three communities to join and help us work towards solving some of these issues together. Thank you.
Thank you, Maya, for that enlightening presentation about canopy coverage, especially in neighborhoods that are underserved. There is many factors that create those types of situations in our communities and make it very disproportionate. And of course, the climate change point just aggravates any health situation for those particular residents. We do have our speaker, our next speaker tuning in soon. From CAL FIRE. While we wait, I wanted to see if anyone has any questions for Maya at this time, just to promote more of like advocacy opportunities. I think Maya's great at what she does, and she obviously wants to great partnership. So if you have any questions right now, I'll give you time while we wait for our next speaker to sign on. You're also welcome to put all your questions down in the chat. We will be having a question and answer and open discussion session at the end after Walter's presentation.
Tracy, do you want me to answer any? Well, it looks like he might be hopping on soon. Do you want me to answer one question while we wait?
Yes, let me look at the chat to see if there's any. Okay, so there is one question from Larry Staley. Just curious, is the case in East Palo Alto with lack of trees area right up the Bay may be harder to grow in Bayland areas?
That's a great question that has come up before, because East Palo Alto is along the Bay and has a different soil type than maybe other parts of the Bay Area. Though many parts of the Bay Area were as Bay, a lot of what we're living on is infill. Entire communities are built on infilled Bay. We found lots of success with growing trees in East Palo Alto. Some species, very few, don't seem to take as well, but we're not exactly confident that's because of the Bayland-like soil. What I've experienced in East Palo Alto is sort of the stuff I outlined, where there's not as much plantable area because parcels are smaller, mostly built out already. And utilities are often put right where like lawns are. If somebody has a lawn, chances are there's a water line under that lawn because it's easy to access. And so when the community was developed, these development patterns made it so now there's many physical barriers to planting trees.
Oh, that's a really good insight as to why there might be disparities. Another question comes from Leanne. Are there any requirements for tree trimmers? I see tree topping in my neighborhood all the time.
Yeah. So most cities, it's illegal to prune a public tree. So if it's a tree along the street, chances are it's a public tree and it is illegal to get those topped. And so those can be reported, but again, it's really hard to like track every tree for cities. I live in San Jose and it's a huge city and with just a few arborists who can't possibly see every topped tree. And so that leads to some lack of oversight, which is really unfortunate. In terms of trees on private property, there's no like regulations for tree trimmers. And I think it depends on the tree trimmer if they have the education of like how pruning large trees or not. It's probably on an individual basis.
And then she also asks, Canopy serves a specific area. Any suggestions to spread or start something similar in San Mateo?
Yeah, and I see Gail's question that's similar. Is there an urban forest alliance in San Mateo County? So starting a nonprofit takes a lot, but I mean, that's how Canopy started. We started as a small group of volunteers, actually, before even becoming a nonprofit in Palo Alto in 1996, I believe, who were passionate about the old oaks that make their community unique and didn't want to see them disappear. So over years, formed into Canopy, a nonprofit that can apply for funding and hire staff and implement some urban forestry projects. I'm happy to talk more individually if you have other questions about that. As far as I know, there is not an urban forest alliance in San Mateo County.
Thank you for that, Maya. I think we'll head back to further questions at the end. And now I'm gonna introduce our next speaker, Walter Passmore from CAL FIRE.
Oh.
Hi, Walter. Thank you for joining us.
Sure. All right, there's the slides. Okay, well, I apologize if I don't sound very energetic right now. This is my seventh meeting today. I didn't know it was possible to have seven meetings in one day, but I am really happy to be here with you all. Look forward to having a constructive conversation. So we're just going to launch right into it. So let's go to the next slide. This is the CAL FIRE team as it currently stands. I am the state urban forester. I manage a program that serves urban forestry programs throughout the state of California. We have two supervisors, Julia Gowan in Northern California and Henry Herrera in Southern California, an education specialist and an analyst in Sacramento headquarters. And then we have regional urban foresters spread throughout the state. So for the Bay Area, that is Tanner Marr. And we are going to be adding additional staff in the near future to increase our capacity to deliver on some of the initiatives that I'm going to be talking about. So next slide. All right, here's where it starts to get exciting. These are the actions that CAL FIRE is currently taking. Green Schoolyards, a new program that was enabled through a legislative priority for fiscal year 22-23. We received 68 applications requesting $355 million worth of grant funding to do projects on 413 campuses. We have $117 million available to award, which sounds like a tremendous amount of money, $117 million. However, there are 10,000 K through 12 public school campuses in California and countless daycare centers that are servicing some of the most vulnerable part of California's population. So we're talking about millions of children that are exposed to extreme heat and pollution on a daily basis. And $117 million is likely to only touch about 1% of what the need is. So we need to do much more. We hope that this is an initial investment on a long-term continuous offering to green schoolyards and do more for California's children and students. We know from science that nature in proximity to learning environments increases students' ability to learn, to concentrate, to form healthy relationships. So there is a range of valuable benefits that are attributed to having trees and vegetation on school campuses. We are also participating to deliver the Inflation Reduction Act, which is historic, unprecedented investment in urban and community forestry at the federal level. The Inflation Reduction Act, just for urban and community forestry, is $1.5 billion with a B. The first allocations went out to states, and so CAL FIRE will be delivering $43.2 million in state projects in increased technical support, information education, and enhancements to key partnerships. We do expect a request for proposals for subgrants to come out sometime this fall. Also want to highlight that, you know, we're working with key partners like the Arbor Day Foundation to enhance their suite of programs that includes Tree City USA, Tree Campus USA, and Tree Line USA. You know, these are some key brands that constituents throughout the nation put a lot of stock in. They have really great reputations. And, you know, I can't tell you how many times someone has come to me and tried to sway my opinion on an important decision because our city was a Tree City USA or a utility was a Tree Line USA. And if you really took this seriously, you would agree with my opinion. So there's this really important brand recognition associated with those programs, and we're hoping to capitalize on it. And I mentioned the request for proposals coming out sometime this fall. And let's go to the next slide. Okay, before I hit this bullet, one more point on Inflation Reduction Act. Currently, the notice of funding opportunity is open at the national level. So that's going to close June 1st, I believe. Hopefully, a lot of you have already started on proposals for the national notice of funding opportunity. If you haven't, it's not too late to consider projects for the state process this fall. It's probably too late to compose a big proposal for the national solicitation. Okay, that's it. There are some policy updates that we're happy to share with everyone. One is that the Urban Forestry Act, which is the state enabling legislation for urban forestry, was updated in 2022 and now requires that CAL FIRE, in conjunction with our local partners, develop a statewide strategic plan to increase canopy 10% by 2035. This is a huge, audacious, optimistic goal. Honestly, I don't know how we're going to get there, but we are going to give it our best shot. There has been a tremendous amount of support and discussion in the state legislature about big topics like green schoolyards. I mentioned that the Green Schoolyards grant is intended to be a first investment, and there's a lot of legislators that are really committed to that $117 million being the first investment of many. We're also looking at additional investments through things such as climate bonds, pocket forests. There are improvements proposed for grant administration, access to funding, advanced payments, lots of things that are helpful to nonprofit groups and local constituents. Strategic plans for green highways, for green schoolyards. There's a lot of interest in the California Climate Investment Strategy to increase investments in urban forestry to address climate impacts. There are updates to the State Hazard Mitigation Plan, which now recognizes extreme heat as a risk. So on par with earthquake, fire, flood. And the primary strategy for mitigating that risk of extreme heat is tree planting and nature-based solutions. So another big portal for us as, you know, groups interested in nature-based solutions to access funding through Office of Emergency Services and their counterpart FEMA. So that is big there. All of this is focused through a lens of diversity, equity, and inclusion. I will tell you right now that if you are not actively reaching those audiences, disadvantaged communities, low-income populations, you're probably not going to receive much support from state agencies and not much chance of getting grant funding. So that needs to be a really important part of your strategies moving forward. We are strongly focused on priority populations and disadvantaged communities. We want to provide resources to those who need it most. And my opinion, that's the role of government. It's not our role just to hand out money to anyone who asks or anyone who can write a well-written proposal. It's our job to get the money out there where it's going to do the most good. And that's with these priority populations and disadvantaged communities. So I'll get off my soapbox with that. Let's go to the next slide. Some more recent updates. We have been working with the Urban Forest Ecosystems Institute at Cal Poly, but we are adding new tools to that. So we're funding an urban forest assessment tool to be added to the suite of tools. We are going to be enhancing the select tree tool to select more climate adapted species, have more customized lists for needs such as school friendly trees, you know, trees that don't have dangerous thorns, don't produce a lot of pollen or allergen. So, you know, trees with attributes that best suit schools that are also climate adapted and can withstand sometimes tough treatment on school campuses. So we are working to enhance those tools that are available to all of our partners throughout the state. The California Schoolyard Forest System was launched in conjunction with our partner Green Schoolyards America. So there's a schoolyard forest system and a resource library. So there's a community of practice associated with that. If you're interested in green schoolyards, I would highly recommend you taking a look at that website and then reaching out to either Green Schoolyards America or Cal Fire if we can give you some additional information. Our workforce development network got launched last year following awards of our first workforce development grants. And we're hoping to expand on that with future grant offerings and also connect in some key partners like California Conservation Corps and the local conservation corps. Through another partner, we are enhancing our presence in encouraging urban wood utilization, making better outlets for diversion of wood waste from trees that need to be removed or pruned in the urban environment, and hopefully save money for local tree service providers and for municipalities on disposal of that wood waste. We're also working closely with Department of Water Resources because we recognize that there are challenges to telling people to grow more trees. So we are hoping to prove scientifically with data that you can grow more trees without using more water. Another announcement on workforce development, we're going to be employing two California Climate Fellows to help us plan for and deliver an urban forestry camp for the next generation. So look out for announcements. We're hoping to deliver the camp summer of 2024. So planning will be in process soon, and we look forward to soliciting participants for next generation people in urban forestry. Next slide. And the call to action. Increasing urban tree canopy statewide is going to be a job that everyone has to contribute to. Cal Fire by no means can do this by ourselves. We can provide some encouragements through the form of technical advice and grants. We can encourage, we can motivate, but it's going to take all of our constituents, nonprofits, to advocate, to inform local residents. It's going to take leaders and stakeholders in communities to encourage the private property owners who own 80% of the urban land area to do the right thing. And we're all going to have to work together to identify where resources need to be applied most to accomplish canopy cover increase. We are going to be working with every jurisdiction, municipal and county in the state, to encourage adoption of policies to accomplish no net loss of canopy for every action. So every permit that crosses a desk for development should result in no net loss or increase of tree canopy. We hope to promote responsible maintenance. I heard Maya talking about no topping and other best practices for tree maintenance. We want to encourage review and improvement of city tree ordinances, because each community has unique needs and they have unique regulatory requirements. We do want to encourage communities that have not updated their ordinance in 10 years or more to take a fresh look at it, to work with stakeholders in their community, and to envision a greener future for their communities. Here's the bullet on the Inflation Reduction Act notice of funding opportunity deadline of June 1st. So that's just to reiterate that point. Another call to action: work with your local schools to increase urban tree canopy and improve tree care on campuses. We know these are really tough environments to grow trees and promote healthy learning environments, but we can do both. And through the help of your advocacy, we will see improvements across all of our campuses, whether they get grants or not. And finally, partnership and collaboration. We're all in this together, but the advocates and constituents for urban forestry are few in comparison to the scale of work that we need to do over the course of the next decade. So we need to think about increasing our capacity, doing more, not doing more with less, but doing more with more. We have never been at a time where more funding and resources were available than now. So I would encourage everyone to think big, think optimistically, be innovative, work together. There is no competition in this space. We all are bringing our strengths to accomplish goals that we never thought possible. So I want to encourage all of you to collaborate, to reach out to us if we can help network your efforts together, and if we can help fund your good ideas. And next slide, I think, is the questions. Yes. So there is my contact information. Thank you again for allowing me to present to this group. I'm willing to answer any questions that folks have.
All right. Thank you, Walter, for sharing that with us. That presentation really brought the bigger picture of what's going on in California when it comes to urban forestry, and how, like you said, that there is more to come. So collaborating and partnering is fundamental at this point in order to get the work done. And we hope that with this presentation and Maya's like advocacy becomes a better tool to promote our management and protection of our urban forests. So with that in mind, I'd like to open up to questions. And I see that Gail already has her hand up. If you'd like to ask your question, Gail.
Sure. I'm unmuted, right? Yes, you can hear me. Great. So Pacifica is working on incorporating a canopy goal in their new climate action plan, but we need tools to not only assess the current canopy, but then assess it at regular intervals to see if we're working towards that goal. Pacifica is a low wealth city, not a lot of money. Is there a tool that we can use with CAL FIRE? that we could have access to for that?
Yeah, there's a couple that are available right now. One through the U.S. Forest Service. The data is a little bit older, but it might be a good point of comparison. If you email me, I can send you the direct links to that and to the Tree Finder tool on the Urban Forest Ecosystem website. That's another one of the suite of tools that we funded using our grant funding. So yeah, you can use those as a starting point. And we are working with Cal Poly to make that data available on a recurring basis. So you would be able to see updates to the data every time we analyze a new set of imagery. So about every 2 years is the current interval. So you'd get an updated assessment that's sub-meter resolution on canopy cover data.
Fabulous. And this is at no cost?
Yes, no cost.
Wonderful. Thank you very much.
Okay. If anyone else wants to go ahead and ask a question, you are welcome to. I will also be referring to the chat to see if there's any questions. Well, we do have one from Larry. I don't know if this is a question or just the, is tree topping and pruning, are they two different things entirely, or if Maya or Walter want to take that one?
Sure. So there are like proper tried and true techniques to pruning a tree. It changes based on its age, but there are ways to prune a tree that allows for healthy growth and strong structure. Topping is, I guess it's a pruning technique potentially, but it's something that's, I think, is easy to understand. And so maybe a lot of residents, I know in my neighborhood, like use the word when they hire somebody to prune their trees, or say, oh, can you top it? I don't want it to grow taller. And so that's why I think topping happens so often.
Yeah, I'll just add a little bit to that topping is a historic practice where a tree is cut evenly at a certain height instead of cutting back to branch connections where the tree is able to seal over the wounds effectively. So topping actually causes trees to be much higher risk for whole tree failure and for branch failure. So we want to discourage topping and encourage proper use of practices for height reduction if that is needed.
And I know that Maya and Walter will be sharing more resources on managing and protecting individual trees. I know that they have a one page. I know Maya has a one pager. We'll be sharing that out. I think she could also be sharing it in the group chat, but it'll definitely be included in the follow up.
Right. Thanks, Tracy. Let me see if I can do that. We have these one page advocacy pieces for North Fair Oaks. They're specific to North Fair Oaks, Menlo Park in Belhaven, and East Palo Alto, available in English and Spanish. And then Cami has her hand raised. She's our interim executive director. Hi, Cami.
Hi, everyone. My name is Cami Lo. I'm with Canopy. I have a question for Walter, and then I would like to share a resource from Canopy. So Walter, my question for you is, I was wondering if you might be able to say more about the water issue that you brought up, meaning we can grow more trees without using more water. And then I would like to share a webinar that Canopy is hosting in June with you all, and I can put the link in the chat box.
Sure. So we've probably all heard in the past that if we want to increase our tree canopy cover, we're going to have to find a new source of water. And people are sometimes immediately resistant to canopy cover goals because the state does have some very real issues with water for irrigation purposes. And, you know, historically we've used potable water for irrigation. So, you know, these are real challenges. However, we think that we can prove scientifically that with newer irrigation systems, with zoned irrigation that gives trees their specific needs, with promoting the practices of the water efficient landscape ordinance, that we can grow more canopy using less water, because we're making more appropriate choices on how we water trees, the amount of water that trees are able to access just with the native soil and natural rainfall that occurs. We think there can be improvements in species selection, but all of these practices combined should result in less water being used to grow more trees. So we can make improvements on both sides of the equation.
Okay, we have another question from the chat. It is, where do we stand on eliminating eucalyptus trees? Understand most of those grown in various places going back to the 1800s have proved to be a great menace.
Oh, sure, on this one, for our programs which serve East Palo Alto, Bohaven, and North Fair Oaks, we've stopped planting them. They are on our approved species list by the state, but we learn and we adapt, and we see that these eucalyptuses don't have like the strongest structure to support an urban setting. So that's what Canopy does, but maybe I can pass it to Walter and he can share more.
So I would say this is a complex conversation, but not all eucalyptus are created equal. There's, you know, actually hundreds of different eucalyptus that are capable of growing in California, and there's only a very few number that cause us big issues. You know, for example, the blue gum eucalyptus has been known to outgrow its space, and it has certain attributes that make it more fire prone or burn hotter than some other species, but it is really the exception. There's a lot of eucalyptus species that are very well adapted to California's current and future climate. And so we should not by any means rule out planting eucalyptus as a genus just because we have one or two actors that don't function well in California.
Wow, I did not know that about eucalyptus trees. Go ahead.
Thanks. Matt Ritter, who's a professor in Cal Poly, says there are 800 species of eucalyptus and that there are many that are actually really going to help grow the urban forest in California. So it is people may see these other species on the street and not know that they're one of the 800.
Yes, thank you for that. I'll just add really quickly that, you know, eucalyptus is not a native species, and that's oftentimes an opposition. However, most of our urban tree canopy is not native. We have very few native species that are well adapted to urban environments. So we need to supplement our native species with well-adapted introduced species. And it's through the wise selection and monitoring of those introduced species that we optimize the benefits that people get from our urban forest.
Okay, our next question comes from Cade. And he says, I know it's still in the earliest of stages, but in regards to growing the urban forest 10% by 2035, what are the plausible pathways of getting there? Can it be done through existing policies in the city and council level, or will it require state level coordination to make it easier to plant? Can you sketch some of those potential pathways at a high level for us? It is urgent health issue for many of our residents.
Agreed. So multiple influences is the answer, meaning that we need improvements to policy, we need improvements to advocacy, we need improvements to funding, we need improvements to personnel, technical resources, you know, all across the board. Everything that influences positive change in the urban forest, we have to do more, we have to do it better, and we have to do it quicker.
Thank you, Walter. And I think I see Nancy raising her hand.
Yeah, thanks. I too, like Gail, am in Pacifica. And we're a coastal community. We also have some very steep hillsides. And we've had a fair amount of development that has removed trees haphazardly. And along with that, all of our cities have a requirement known as RENA, which is a housing unit number that we have to meet. So there's pressure to build housing, particularly affordable housing. And my question is how to find that balance between preserving and even increasing tree canopy with proposed development, because there's pressure in particular on housing to develop, and how, you know, aside from just being vocal residents in the community, you know, where we can look to the state, I think in particular, to say, you know, here are some policies that you need to recognize.
So I would say this is, it's not an easy question to answer. And there's not a one size fits all answer for every community. I will tell you that while I was urban forester for Palo Alto, we put in a policy of no net loss of canopy. That was very easy to understand, and that applied to every single permit decision, every single project that was implemented in the city. So public and private property, and there were options. If the trees could not be retained on the site, you know, after exploring reasonable changes to the proposed development, then there were options to plant trees near the site or off the site in a location where more trees were needed. And if that option was not viable, then there was an option to pay into an in-lieu development fund where, you know, the city could apply those funds to plant more trees elsewhere. And in Palo Alto, part of that in lieu development fund was used to fund canopy to plant trees on private property, help the private property owners, and monitor those trees for a time period. I think that type of model could be adapted to almost any city, but probably is going to have to be modified somewhat to fit the unique needs of your community.
I'm looking at, so we have Haley who would like to ask, can you talk more about opportunities to integrate stormwater management in tree canopy?
There are aligned programs in state government, and the one that we work with the most on stormwater management is the Urban Greening Program, not to be confused with the Urban Forestry Program. They are very similar. Both programs can plant trees. The Urban Greening Program funds more of the infrastructure improvements for stormwater management, such as infiltration areas, bioswales, rain gardens, and less of the planning or urban forest management activities, which is more the focus of the Urban Forestry Program. So that funding is available through Urban Greening, but it's not exclusive. So, you know, if you have a project that is more focused on the infrastructure components of stormwater management, Urban Greening is probably a better fit. If your project has less infrastructure improvement and more tree planting and urban forest planning, then Urban Forestry Program is probably a better fit. There is a California state grants library portal where you can search hundreds and hundreds of grants and find out what the best fit is for your project. And if you have any difficulty navigating that, reach out to your nearest state employee. We should be all happy to help you try to find the best grant to fit your project. Sorry, didn't silence my cell phone.
No worries. If you could share the link with us, Walter, that'd be amazing.
Oh yeah, State Grants Library, sure.
If there's anyone else, if anyone else is interested in more information, we'll definitely be
pasted in the chat.
Thank you, Walter. All right, so I think. If no one else has a question, I think we could probably end our meeting early. I really want to thank our speakers today for their time and having the opportunity to learn both what's going on at the local level when it comes to urban forestry and what is going on at the state level. Definitely showed us ways that we could work together and advocate for our urban forests. And with that, thank you for joining us today. Hope you found the information helpful and that you are encouraged to and protect and manage our urban forests. Please join us next month on our next ENS tag on active transportation. Until then, stay safe and healthy.